for this session. Thank you for joining the session today, new major release of GRASS GIS. With us today, we have Vesek Petras. He is a research software engineer focusing on creating spatio-temporal models and tools for geospatial research. He is a researcher, open source developer, and an advocate for open science. He has been a member of the GRASS GIS development team since 2012 and serves on its project steering committee. And he holds a master's in geoinformatics from Czech Tech and a PhD in geospatial analytics from NC State. I'll hand it over to you, Vesek.
Thank you. As you have heard, my name is Vesek Petras, and I will be talking about the new major release of GRASS GIS. My co-author, Anna Petrášová, is in the chat, and she will post a link to this slide deck there. When I sent the bio to NCGIS, it was before GRASS GIS project steering committee election, and I was a member then, and I was re-elected, so that still holds. I'm also a member of Open Source Geospatial Foundation, and if you are interested in open source, that's one of the ways how to get more involved is to apply for membership. If you would like to ask me sometime later privately about either of the universities I studied, Czech Tech in Prague or NC State in Raleigh, I will be happy to do that. In this presentation, I will be presenting a work of the whole GRASS.js community, which creates the GRASS.js software and also provides it to the public, including the source code, so that anybody can do whatever they desire with that, as long as it is an open source software. And that includes all the latest additions and developments which are included in the preview version. So really the credit doesn't go to us as authors of this presentation, but to the whole community. The community today looks more like this, where we are meeting virtually. And actually for GRASS.js, we were always a virtual community. And it's a community of both developers and users, and there are not necessarily any strict boundaries in between those or between outsiders and insiders in the community. Everything which happens is open, happens on the internet. People who are contributing to the project are contributing code, documentation, translations, and more. I mentioned the project steering committee. That's a group of elected people from the community who are making the most important decisions. The current and new PSC chair is Veronika Andreo. One of the main things which you probably already heard about GRASS.js is that it is open source. And it doesn't mean that there is some license on the code or that the code is available. That's all true. But we embrace the fact that you can actually export the code if you desire to do so. So at the end of documentation for each component, there is a link to the source code where you can see not only the source code, but also all the changes to it. All important components also have a strong scientific foundation. The documentation both links to related scientific papers, as well as to papers which are somehow associated with that specific tool. For example, they're published when the tool was published in as a part of GRASS.js. When you learn GRASS.js, it's really a good investment of time, because we put a big emphasis on backwards compatibility. So that may not a halt in sense of that the button in the graphical user interface is on the same place as it was last year. I will talk about some changes later on, but with the major concepts, it actually halts. Of course, there are no increasing license fees over time since it is open source, and the open source nature also makes it employer and contractor independent. When you install GRASS, you get a lot of tools right away, and we include all mature tools into that installation, but you can also download experimental tools from the internet. And the spatial analysis which is included ranges from network analysis to hydrology to remote sensing and more. In this talk, I will focus on an upcoming release, version 8, and that's scheduled sometime in the spring, scheduled to have Proj 6 and Proj 7 support, so all modern coordinate reference system manipulations should be available in the new version, and I will talk about some other features now. The feature which is really important for me is dark beam support. That's what I'm using on my computer, so you will see a lot of screenshots with that. And that's available when your system is actually set in dark theme. What is maybe more important though is an improved first-time user experience, where the initial GRASS.js project setups automatically, and you are also provided with guidance on next steps. This was a big hurdle in the past, but hopefully we polished that, and now it's quite simple to do. This work was done by Linda Kladivová, but also the whole GRASS.js community contributed with many reviews, code reviews, tests, user surveys, and so on. And this was related to another component which we completely recreated, and that's a data management component where all the data manipulation in GRASS.js is now centralized, and all the access to the database or the GRASS projects you do from there. It really changed how I'm using GRASS.js. So even though I'm already using it for a couple of years, so I think this is a big change. And if you had some hurdles in GRASS.js in the past, I hope this will remove them for you. On the other hand, if you have some feedback as a long-term GRASS.js user, we are happy to hear that too. There is a lot of functional and algorithmic improvements in GRASS.js. One example of it is generating of skeletons and centerlines from Voronoi polygons for lakes and rivers. Another example of a newly added feature or improvement is faster external data links. This is useful when you are using GRASS.js just for part of your workflow. Of part of processing, let's say in R, or you are using GRASS.js as an API in your cloud application, or if you are just using GRASS.js as part of your desktop JS workflow, but you are not necessarily using GRASS.js 100%, these faster external links can help you process geotiffs and other raster files in much more efficient way. A big change, which is not necessarily a feature of the software itself, but it's part of the community developments, is that we moved to GitHub. So everything now happens there. Maybe you have seen with some open source projects this fork me on GitHub button on their website, which really means that you can get involved in the project quite closely through that github.com service. It means that you can fill issues or tickets for all these projects with just a single login, and also all the issues are, of course, visible there. How it works is that maybe you are thinking about, oh, this would be such a great feature if GrassGS would have that. You can actually suggest features like this with a feature request, which is created as an issue on GitHub. Here we see a user creating a request about how to handle creation of or changing map set and location, which is related to one of the features I was showing. And the issue is now closed when I took the screenshot because that was actually already addressed. You can also be unlucky and find a bug, but that's really a good thing because you can take screenshots, you can copy paste any outputs you have and create another issue, which would be classified as a bug report, and you report it on GitHub, and this way you will actually tell others, hey, there is some issue you may want to look at it. This one again was closed when I took the screenshot. When a developer or contributor decides to make a change, like fixing the issue or adding the feature, what they do is that they propose the change using a mechanism which is called a pull request. This is really a developer talk, but it's useful to know when you want to get engaged in the community and you then understand what is the lingo there. Developer suggests these changes in a pull request, and the pull request is actually first automatically checks by number of different automated checks, which ensure that the code quality and functionality is in the standards we require. And after that, we do manual testing. Some of this manual testing is also something which users can do if they have a little more advanced setup. And this is repeated as needed. And that's how new features and fixes are getting into GrassGIS. If you are a user, that might be not necessarily super relevant for you. But if you are a teacher or a student and you are interested in writing some code, even maybe just some simple Python code, there is a stipend program for students by Google to contribute to open source projects. Now it's starting. It's not time to apply yet, but it will be soon. And there are actually new rules this year. So if you were not eligible previous years or it was not a good match, you should check it now because there's greater eligibility and shorter commitment to the project. For that, you have to engage with the community, like the OSGeo community or GrassGIS, and apply at Google separately. If you are a user, you are probably more interested in where to get support for GrassGIS. There are two basic types of support. One is the community support. We are using a mailing list. That would be like a traditional way of getting support. And then we are using GS Stack Exchange website. Commercial support is provided by a couple of different companies, including Center for Geospatial Analytics at NC State. And we are providing different kinds of support in relation to GrassGIS, general development support, research and software engineering as a service. We can do personalized training, skill transfer, and we are also creating several tools for GrassGIS, and we can provide support for those. And I will show you some of these tools. One is Futures, which is a set of tools for urban growth modeling. And there will be actually a poster about it at 5 p.m. Right after this talk. So you can check it there. Then we are working on POPS, which stands for Pest or Pathogen Spread Simulation. And that's used for sudden oak death, spotted lanternfly spread in the United States. And it both requires some calibration, but on the other hand, it's available in GrassGIS for you. And then we are working on tangible landscape, which is a tangible geospatial user interface, which allows you to use all these tools from GRASS, GIS, in an interactive sandbox. Now we are actually working or testing it actually live in a remote classroom. And another example of such an extension, which you can download from somebody somebody else than us, is this Valley Bottom Flatness Index tool, which allows you to look into terrain. It is just one of the tools in GRASS.js for terrain analysis and some more advanced dissecting of your terrains. And then there is a couple tools I would like to draw your attention to, and these are tools for automated download of different data sets, global or partial local data sets. Here I highlight Sentinel, MODIS, Landsat, NED, and Naive Imagery. And how it works is that you download an extension from GRASS.js add-ons, and then you use that. Some of these tools require credentials to access the government website where you download the dataset. And this is an easy way how to get these data into GRASS.js in a very just with a one run of a tool. There is here a list of resources. All of these are links. So if you get the link to the presentation, you can go through these. The GRASS.js documentation is really detailed. Some people really highlight this as one of the biggest advantages of GRASS.js, the documentation. But we have also tutorials, which are much better for learning. And if you prefer books, there are books about GRASS.js as well. If you click the link in the presentation, in next 24 hours, you can download GRASS.js for free. You can also do it after the 24 hours. Here are some of my contacts, linked to the presentation, and thank you for listening. Now is the time for questions.
Great, thank you, Vashik. We have not been able to post the link in the chat because it's not accepting links, but you have it on the slide, so that's perfect. So anybody listening in, please feel free to write that down if you would like to check out the slides and also get to those resource links on the other slide. And please feel free to enter the chat room by clicking join chat, and any questions you might have, you can put them in through there. We do have a couple comments, no questions quite yet, but a couple comments came in. Stephanie says, these are exciting new developments. And Doug Newcomb says, love the R. external speedups. No questions as of yet, but we can stay on the line for a little longer.
Yeah, one thing I would say is about the community and the new developments. That I would like to highlight the thing that, or the fact that you can actually engage the developers. Mm-hmm. Also, it's not that these developments happen and maybe there is this annoying bug or this button works in the way you think it shouldn't work. And mm-hmm. it's nothing you can't change. The developer community is open. Everything happens in the open, but also you don't have to become a some official member or pays an entrance fee to get in. You just go on the mailing list, or you sign up on GitHub and send an issue and say, hey, I have this and this problem.
That's awesome. Yeah. We do have one question that's come in. Doug is asking, are you looking at the new automotive LiDARs for use with tangible GIS?
We are actually not looking at that. It's interesting. We are working with, we are traditionally using Microsoft Kinect sensors. Now there is kind of a third generation Kinect for Azure, and we are quite happy with some of its features. And Tangible Landscape now works with that. I guess it's still in the testing though. Some of these new LiDARs, when they are like now getting cheaper and cheaper, they are becoming more and more interesting for Tangible Landscape. Because there, actually the goal there is that it is low cost. Obviously you have to get some fancy hardware to get it working, but it's affordable.
Great. A few more questions have actually come in. So Megan is asking, can you create voxel layers in grass?
This is a great question. Yes. Yeah, you can. There is in GRASS.js, there are these groups of modules, and the modules which can manipulate the voxel models are starting with R3 for 3D rasters.
Okay. So they're noticing on your slide how you have mentioned GRASS.GIS is free within the next 24 hours and wondering how much it's going to cost after that. But they've been chatting that they think it's free. I think you also mentioned that.
Yeah, right. It's even after that 24 hours, it's free, yes.
Yeah. Somebody else mentioned they lost audio. I didn't lose audio, but they did. Audio on the dark screen slide. So maybe when you're showing some of those images and it was all a kind of a blacker screen, was that of any importance? They're asking those slides.
Yeah, the first one was about GRASS.GIS actually supporting dark theme if it is set in your system. Mm. So if your operating system can be set to a dark theme, which is common for Mac for a long time, for example, GRASS.GIS will respect that. So it's partially aesthetics, but partially accessibility issue for some.
Excellent. Okay. That is all the questions that have come through so far. I will conclude the session thanking Vasek and Anna, who was in the background, for joining us today and providing all this great information. I like open source GIS. Next, we have the social beginning at 5. And of course, as mentioned earlier, there's the poster presentation session, and they have a poster in that session. So please go check that out and vote for your favorite poster in the session. The social is beginning at 5 and runs till about 6:30, maybe longer, depending on participation.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.